So good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this session of ECHO today. And I'm thankful to all of you for sparing time in this chaotic times. It's a really chaotic time. And though today we wanted to do our 51st session, sort of slightly celebrate, but it has all been called off because of the pandemic that we are facing, the COVID-19 pandemic. And we thought that it would be a good idea if today we took this opportunity to talk to our ART centers about COVID. I am Dr. Upasna. I work in the National Institute of TB and Respiratory Diseases. Then on my right is Dr. J.K. Saini. He's a senior chest physician at the National Institute of TB and Respiratory Diseases. And he is the nodal officer for NITRD for COVID-19 response. Then on my left, I have Dr. Vandana from Share India. And I have support from ECHO India by Gaurav and by Shivam. So with an introduction to my team, I welcome all of you. I can see that CBC also has logged in. Hi, Christine. And I can see several people who have logged in. I can see the STDC and all our ART centers from Delhi, UP, Andhra, and Tamil Nadu. With these few introductory comments, I would request you to mark your attendance. We will pull up the poll of attendance. Then a small pretest. Nothing big. Then a talk by Dr. Saini and an open house of questions. So I think now we would just move on to our session. As you all know, COVID-19 has taken the world by storm on 31st December 2019. The first case of COVID-19 was reported from Wuhan, China. And since then, we are now seeing more than 3 lakh cases in about 117 countries. And it was declared as a pandemic on the 11th March by WHO. I don't think any healthcare worker, by the end of it, any healthcare worker can say that they did not get a chance to help in the process. And this is a time when the world is actually looking at the healthcare workers. And we would also need to stop doing our ECHO sessions because of the lockdown in Delhi and other 75 districts of the country. But before we discontinued our ECHO clinics for some time, we thought we should stop after we have given you some information about COVID-19. With this small introductory statement, I'll pass over the mic to Dr. J.K. Saini. He's a senior chest physician and he is responsible for the COVID response in our hospital. And I request him to share his thoughts, his knowledge, and whatever insight he can give to us in this problem.
Good afternoon, everyone. As the introduction already given by the madam.
Thank you, Dr. Saini. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, everyone. The objective of my presentation will be introduction about the COVID-19, then what mode of transmission, epidemiology, clinical features, diagnostic modalities, treatment, and some aspect of prevention. Towards December 2019, novel coronavirus was identified as a cause of upper and lower respiratory tract infection in Wuhan, in a city, the Hubei province of China. It rapidly spread, resulting in an epidemic throughout China and then visually spreading to other parts of the world in pandemic proportions. It has affected almost every continent in this world except Antarctica. In February 2020, the World Health Organization designated the disease COVID-19, which stands for Coronavirus Disease 2019. SARS coronavirus 2 is a coronavirus of family coronaviridae that are common human beings as well as animals that commonly affects, like camels, cattle, cats, and bats. Coronavirus comprises of large family of viruses. 7 different strains of coronavirus are identified. Alpha coronavirus, then beta coronavirus, 2 strains, then Middle East region syndrome coronavirus, and then SARS coronavirus, and this particular COVID-19 coronavirus 2. SARS coronavirus 2. It's a novel coronavirus that causes coronavirus disease 2019 or COVID-19. Coronavirus are large viruses, spherical in shape with a helical capsid and a lipid envelope. These are sense positive RNA viruses which can directly multiply in a host cell due to the presence of the RNA polymerase. Sometimes coronavirus from animals infect people and spread further via human-to-human transmission, such as MERS coronavirus, SARS coronavirus 1, and now with COVID-19, coronavirus disease 2019. The virus that causes COVID-19 is designated severe acute respiratory syndrome or SARS-CoV-2, previously referred to as 2019 novel coronavirus. So now the disease will be termed as the coronavirus disease 2019, and the virus is termed as SARS coronavirus 2. The understanding of mode of transmission is currently incomplete. The initial concept was that the virus originated from snakes. However, later studies proved that it had more similarity with the bats. However, as the outbreak progressed, person-to-person transmission through droplets and fomites became the primary mode of transmission. Now, how it spreads from person to person? It usually spreads from one person to another person through droplet transmission. The virus is released in the respiratory secretions when an infected person coughs, sneezes, or talks. These droplets can infect others if they make direct contact with the mucous membrane. Infection can also occur by touching an infected surface and followed by touching the eyes, nose, and mouth. Droplets typically do not travel more than 6 feet, that is about 2 meters, and do not linger in the air. Patients are thought to be most contagious when they are symptomatic. Some spread might be possible before symptoms appear, but this is not thought to be common occurrence. So if we see the latest updated 22nd March, there have been 2,94 confirmed cases of COVID-19 disease, and out of these, around 13,000 deaths have been reported. And it has already occupied most of the countries of the world. Around 186 countries have already detected the COVID-19 cases. The incubation period, the exact incubation period is not known. It is presumed to be between 2 to 4 days after exposure, with most cases occurring within 5 days after exposure. The spectrum of illness and severity, the most infections are self-limiting. This is very important. And COVID-19 tends to cause more severe illness in elderly population or in patients with underlying comorbid medical problems. As per the report from Chinese Center for Disease Control and Prevention, that included approximately 44,500 confirmed COVID-19 patients. The mild illness was reported in 81% of patients. Severe illness was reported in 14% of patients. And critical disease, that is respiratory failure, shock, multi-organ dysfunction syndrome, was reported in 5% of patients. Overall case fatalities varying from 2.3 to 5%. So mostly, as we already discussed in the last slide, mostly middle-aged and elderly patients are affected. Symptomatic infection in children appears to be uncommon, and when it occurs, it is usually mild. Clinical presentation: in a study which was published in New England Journal of Medicine, in which the experience of this Wuhan outbreak of around 1,100 patients, they published in NEJM, and that showed that around 88% patients were having fever. Then fatigue was in 38%, dry cough was in 67% of cases, myalgia was present in around 15% of patients, dyspnea was present in around 18% of patients. And pneumonia appears to be the most common manifestation in patients who are having severe acute respiratory illness. In this group of patients, breathing difficulty developed after a median 5 days of illness. ARDS developed in around 3.4% of patients. Other symptoms which were noted are less common: headache, sore throat, rhinorrhea, and gastrointestinal symptoms. So So now we come to the case definition. The case definitions are based on the current information and will be revised as new information is collected. Countries may need to adapt case definition depending on their own epidemiological situations. So who is a suspected case of corona COVID-2019 disease? A patient with acute respiratory illness, that is, patient must be having, should be having fever and at least one sign or symptom of respiratory disease, that is, cough or shortness of breath. Along with this, there is no other etiology for these symptoms, and a history of travel or residence in a country or area or territory that has reported the local transmission of COVID-19 disease during the 14 days prior to the symptom onset. So these three criteria should be fulfilled to label a case as a suspect case of COVID-2019 disease. The another definition, a patient with any acute respiratory illness and who has been a contact of a confirmed or probable case of COVID-19 disease during the 14 days prior to the onset of the symptoms. Third definition is a patient with severe acute respiratory infection, that is fever and with the acute respiratory symptoms like cough and shortness of breath, and who requires hospitalization and who has no other etiology that fully explains the clinical presentation. And fourth is the case for whom testing for COVID-19 is inconclusive. Then what is a probable case? A probable case for whom testing for COVID-19 infection is inconclusive. The result of the test report given by the laboratory is inconclusive, or for whom testing was positive but on a pen coronavirus assay. So that will be labeled as a probable case. Then a confirmed case of COVID-19 is a person with laboratory confirmation infection with COVID-19 virus, irrespective of clinical signs and symptoms. Then what are close contacts? Close contact of a probable or confirmed case is defined as a person living in the same household as a COVID-19 case, or a person having had direct physical contact with a COVID-19 case, for example, shaking hands, or a person having unprotected direct contact with infectious secretions of a COVID-19 case, for example, being coughed on, touching used paper tissues with a bare hand, or a person having had face-to-face contact with COVID-19 case within 2 meters and more than 15 minutes. Then another definition of close contact is a person who was in a closed environment, for example, classroom, meeting room, hospital waiting room, with a COVID-19 case for 15 minutes or more and at a distance of less than 2 meters. The healthcare worker or other person providing direct care to a COVID-19 case, or laboratory worker handling the specimen from a COVID-19 case without recommended personal protective equipments, or with a possible breach of personal protective equipments. A contact in an aircraft sitting within 2 seats in any direction of the COVID-19 case, or travel company companions or person providing care and crew members serving in the section of the aircraft where the index case was seated. So these all will be designated as close contacts. Then in a patient who is a confirmed case of COVID-19, the main laboratory findings will be their WBC count can vary. It does not provide accurate information about the COVID-19. There can be leukopenia, leukocytosis, lymphopenia, and lymphopenia is more common seen in more than 80% of patients. Lymphopenia is the main finding. Mild thrombocytopenia is commonly seen. However, thrombocytopenia is considered as a poor prognostic sign. Then the inflammatory marker serum troponin is often normal at the time of admission. However, it increases in patients who require ICU care. Then CRP, COVID-19 increases CRP. This seems to track with disease severity and prognosis also. Then patients who meet the criteria for suspect cases, as discussed above, should undergo testing for SARS-CoV-2 and also respiratory pathogens. Respiratory specimen collection from the upper and in particular lower respiratory tract should be performed under strict airborne infection control measures. Preferably, these samples should be obtained as early as symptom onset, since it yields higher virus concentrations. Then recommendations for sample collection. Collection of specimen to test SARS-CoV-2 from the upper respiratory tract, that is either nasopharyngeal swab or oropharyngeal swab, is the preferred method for diagnosis. Induction of sputum collection is not recommended because there are chances of aerosol generation. Bronchoscopy, being an aerosol generating procedure, has got the potential to transmit infection to others. In view of this, preferably avoid performing it and limit its use, clearing secretion, mucus plugs in intubated patients only. All respiratory specimen collection procedures should be done in negative pressure. Additional specimen like blood, stool, urine can be collected to rule out other native or supportive diagnosis. The current recommendation diagnostic modality for SARS-CoV-2 RNA is detected by PCR, RT-PCR method. Results are generally available within few hours to two days. A single positive test should be confirmed by a second RT-PCR assay targeting a different SARS-CoV-2 gene. If initial testing is negative, but the suspicion for COVID-19 remains, the WHO recommends resampling and testing from multiple respiratory tract sites. For safety reasons, a specimen from a patient with suspected or documented COVID-19 should not be submitted for viral culture. Samples should also be tested for other viral or bacterial infections. Then the role of bronchoscopy for collection of the sample. As we already discussed, we should avoid it because it generates the aerosols and there are chances of getting infection to the person who is performing it. The benefits are it helps in obtaining bowel samples in patients who are not able to expectorate sputum for checking bacterial culture, AFP smear or gene expert. Bronchoscope can be used to clear out mucus plugs and ventilated patients of COVID-19 disease. The risk we have already discussed, there are risks. Bronchoscopy should not be done only for the purpose of ruling COVID-19. The risk of transmission of infection to others is extremely high. This we have already discussed. Then radiology in COVID-19 infection. Chest X-ray. The findings of chest X-ray are not specific. And in the initial phases of the disease, the studies could be, chest X-ray could be normal. The most common feature include lobar or multi-lobar or bilateral lung consolidation. Then CT findings, recent studies of around 21 patients, they have published and they found that there are 4 stages in the CT. In the early stage, that is from day 0 to day 4 from the onset of the symptom, in which there will be ground glass opacities with subpleural distribution and involving predominantly the lower lobes. Some patients in this stage could have a normal CT also. Then second stage, that is progressive stage, 5 to 8 days after the onset of the symptom, the finding usually is evolved as rapidly involvement the two lungs or multiple lobes distribution with ground glass opacities, crazy paving and consolidation of air spaces. Then at the peak stage, that is from day 9 to day 13, the consolidation becomes denser and it was present in almost all the cases. Other findings was residual parenchymal bands. Then the last stage, that is the absorption stage or recovery stage, there will be no crazy paving pattern was observed and the GGO could remain even after 14 days. Then we come to the management of COVID-19 patients. Initial management at the moment, the therapeutic strategies to deal with infections are only supportive and prevention aimed at reducing the transmission in the community is our best weapon. Aggressive isolation measures in China have led to the progressive reduction of cases in the last few days. In Italy, in geographic regions of the north, political and health authorities are making incredible effort to contain the shock wave that is severely testing the health system. who all needs the isolation? Any person diagnosed with SARS-CoV-2 infection by means of laboratory testing at a government recommended testing laboratory should be isolated. Anyone who has symptoms of fever and respiratory illness and has a history of close contact with a person who has either been diagnosed as COVID-19 or has a history of travel to a COVID-affected region within last 14 days has to be isolated. Any healthcare worker with symptoms of fever and respiratory illness who has been involved directly in treating the patients of COVID-19 disease has to be isolated. COVID-19 patients or has close contact with persons involved in treating COVID-19 patients during the last 14 days. Where to isolate? A symptomatic case with exposure to COVID-19 positive patients can be quarantined at their homes, but under strict surveillance by the government authorities. Suspected patients to be isolated in well-ventilated, preferably separate rooms. Symptomatic COVID-19 positive patients should be hospitalized in an isolation room and also should be monitored adequately by medical team. Sputum and bowel samples should be collected from isolation room on a separate space with HEPA filters or negative pressure ventilation. Then wearing and removing personal protective equipment. Before entering the isolation room or area, collect all the necessary items of their personal protective equipment. Ensure to perform hand hygiene with an alcohol-based hander or soap and water. Use PPE in order that ensures adequate placement of PPE items and prevent self-contamination and self-inoculation while using and taking of personal protective equipment. While leaving the isolation room, what precautions should be taken? Either remove PPE in the anteroom, or if there is no anteroom, make sure that PPE will not contaminate others, either the environment outside or isolation room or area or other people. Remove PPE in a manner that prevents self-contamination or self-inoculation with contaminated PPE or hands. The general principle is that remove the most contaminated PPE item first. Perform hand hygiene after leaving the isolation room. Immediately after removing the gloves, remove the mask or particulate respirator last. Discard disposable items in a closed rubbish bin. Put reusable items in a dry closed container. Perform hand hygiene with an alcohol-based hander or soap water. Then what precautions to be given for patients who are isolated? Preferably, patients should be wearing mask, face mask, as much as time possible in a day. Restrict movement of patient for chest x-ray, CT scans, labs, as this led to dissemination of infection. Attached urinals or washroom facility in all isolation should be there. Separate portable stethoscope, x-ray, CT unit, COG machine should be dedicated for patients suffering from COVID-19. Patients need to be kept in isolation till both respiratory samples turn out to be negative, which are taken at least 24 hours apart. So before declaring a patient as non-infectious, there should be two samples should be negative, which must be taken at least 24 hours apart. Then treatment options available for COVID-19. There is no specific antiretroviral treatment recommended for COVID-19. And no vaccine is currently available at time of writing of this presentation. Mild disease, these patients are usually present with symptoms of upper respiratory tract infection, low grade fever, shortness of breath, sometimes hemoptysis, GI symptoms, and without the change of mental status, non-immunocompromised. Recommendation is to consider for home isolation in asymptomatic or mild disease. Patient should be advised for home isolation. Who needs admission in COVID-19? A patient with severe disease, that is respiratory rate of more than 30 per minute, saturation less than 93%, PO2 FiO2 ratio of less than 300, and lung infiltrates occupying more than 50% of the lungs within 24 to 48 hours. Then critically ill, these will be around 5% of all COVID positive patients. Respiratory failure, septic shock, and MOCS. At present, there is no drug of choice, only supportive treatment with oxygen, then to maintain the saturation around 90, conservative fluid management, empirical antibiotics as per CAP guidelines, and high dependency and ICU care when needed. No antiretroviral therapy has been proven to work for COVID-19 in humans. Multiple RCTs are going. Hopefully, they will bring further information. Whenever possible, patients should be enrolled in randomized controlled trial. Information is provided below. Some or more popular agents which are being used by some practitioners, but at present they are not recommended. They are as a part of the investigational drug. The focus is placed on lopinavir, ritonavir, and chloroquine since these agents are currently available, but still they have not been proved in the clinical trials. Here we can summarize it in the nutshell. Mild illness without any risk factor or comorbidity, they can be taken care of as the outpatient care, strict home quarantine, monitored by government and health authorities, supportive care, and assess patient's clinical condition via telephonic conversation or using telemedicine facility. Then patients who are having moderate illness, that is dyspnea, hypoxemia, and infiltrates, admit in hospital isolation room. Supportive care should be given. Start empirical antibiotic. There is a recommendation of giving oseltamivir 150 mg BD, and consider starting hydroxychloroquine, lopinavir, ritonavir if evident risk factor for progression of disease are present, but they are not having the proven efficacy. Then in patients who are critically ill, mechanical ventilated patients or multi-lobar or bilateral lung consolidation, these are the recommendation, but mostly supportive and as per the guidelines for managing the patients on ventilator or NIV. These are the various drugs, but the option listed below are not licensed for treatment of COVID-19 still. They can be used either as a off-label use, like hydroxychloroquine has been tested. It has shown some role in vitro, but still no animal study or human study available. Oseltamivir, remdesivir, lopinavir, ritonavir combination or ribavirin. Then critical care management, this we can skip. This is for patients who are on mechanical ventilation. These are as per standard guidelines for managing the patients on mechanical ventilation. Then when to discharge the patient, resolution of symptoms, then radiological improvement should be there, and documented virological clearance in two samples at least 24 hours apart. Then the prognostic factor, the vast majority of infected patients do not get significantly ill or do not require hospitalization. Among hospitalized patients, 10 to 20% patients are admitted to ICU, 3 to 10% require intubation, 2 to 5% dies. Long-term outer prolonged ventilator stay. As the epidemic progresses, an issue which may arise is a large volume of patients unable to breathe from the mechanical ventilation. Then these are the epidemiological risk factors, which we have already discussed, comorbid conditions and older age. Then prevention, can the virus stay on inanimate surfaces? COVID-19 virus can persist on inanimate surfaces like metal, glass, plastic for up to 9 days, but can be efficiently inactivated by surface disinfection procedures within 60 to 70% of ethanol, 0.5% hydrogen peroxide, or 1.1% sodium hypochlorite within 1 minute. Other biocidal agents such as benzalkonium chloride and chlorhexidine are less effective. Hence, terminal disinfection is important even after the patient getting discharged. Then, various what should be included in the personal protective equipment: gloves, mask, face shields, and then N95 mask and surgical mask. These are N95 mask and other masks like FFP2, FFP3, and N100 mask. FFP1 mask, which protect or we which filter out the more than 80% of particles which are 0.3 micron, more than 0.3 micron in diameter. Then N95, which is commonly used in our country, it means 95% of the particles more than 0.3 micron are filtered out. While the specification, as per NIOSH specification, we have to use N95 mask. Then surgical masks are primarily designed to protect vulnerable patients from medical professionals, stopping the bearer from spreading their germs when coughing and sneezing or speaking. So they are designed to protect the patients, not to protect the wearer. There is not currently research available on the efficacy of surgical masks for protecting wearers against the coronavirus. Recommendation for use of the surgical or triple layer mask. Asymptomatic individuals wearing masks of any type is not recommended. Wearing masks when they are not indicated results in unnecessary cost and procurement burden. People with respiratory symptoms or who are taking care of COVID-19 patients at home should receive triple layer surgical mask. N95 mask should be reserved for aerosol generating. This is very important. And at present, the recommendation for using N95 mask is only in those procedures which can generate the aerosol procedures like tracheal intubation, NIV, tracheostomy, bronchoscopy, or cardiopulmonary resuscitation of a proven confirmed COVID-19 patients. So the conclusion is coronavirus disease was reported as cluster of disease in China in December 2019. It has since spread all continents except Antarctica. Elderly persons with comorbidities are more affected. It spreads mainly via respiratory droplets. Pneumonia is the most common complication. Severe cases have a mortality rate of around 2.3 to 5%. Presently, there is no standard treatment or vaccine available for COVID-10. Containment and prevention is the best option.
So thank you, Dr. Saini. Thank you very much. I think this was a much required talk. And I will just summarize the talk for the benefit of the house. Well, the most important point that Dr. Saini told us was that SARS-CoV-2 is the virus which is causing this problem, and the disease is called COVID-19. So you get COVID-19 and it is caused by SARS-CoV-2 virus. It is a coronavirus, and there have been some other coronaviruses also about which the world has some experience, like the initial SARS virus and the Middle Eastern respiratory distress virus. Now, how is it spread? Whatever we know till now, it is said that it is spread by, it is an airborne infection, and it can be spread directly by droplets if you are within 6 feet of an infected person, or through fomites. By fomites, we mean infected surfaces or articles, by touching infected surfaces and articles, and then maybe self-inoculating yourself with whatever is on those infected surfaces. The common presentation would be fever, cough, shortness of breath. Some people also get sore throat. Some people also get runny nose. Some people get diarrhea. And there could be some people who also get other problems like, there could be some other vague symptoms like myalgia. And it is important till the community transmission has taken on full blown, till now, it is still important to know if there is a history of travel within the past 14 days to a country or region affected by COVID-19, or if they have been in contact with a COVID-19 case who was symptomatic. So these histories are important to this symptom screen, and this history is important. Are important to diagnose a suspected case of COVID-19. Anybody who is suspected of COVID-19 has to go to a Nodal COVID-19 testing center, where they will be tested by a PCR method, an RT-PCR method, by which person will be tested, and then the result will be available from about 5 hours to 2 days, and you would come to know whether the patient is positive or not. And for patients who are positive or who are still under investigation, one needs to quarantine them or self-isolate them. Some other things that we see in a patient of COVID-19 is that they can have lymphopenia. Lymphopenia is seen in as many as 80% of cases, and there is a raised liver enzymes. Thrombocytopenia is actually is actually associated with a poor prognosis when present in a COVID-19 patient. X-ray and CT are the radiological tests of choice, but please understand they can be normal in the initial 2 to 5 days. Even the COVID sample can be negative in the initial time, even when a person is infected. So it makes a case for re-examination, retesting, and re-X-raying and re-CTing in a patient who still continues to have symptoms and who still seems to have COVID-19, even though he has tested positive. Please understand that the management basically depends upon isolation, testing, and supportive management. There is no specific antiviral therapy as of now. And when it comes to protection of personnel, somebody who is asymptomatic or not in contact with any possible COVID-19 suspect, there is no point in wearing a mask. But if you are a healthcare worker and if you come in contact with patients, but you do not specifically manage a patient of COVID-19, a surgical mask is more than enough. Now, if you are a healthcare worker who also has taken care of a COVID-19 patient, but you were not involved in any aerosol generating procedure on that patient, then too a surgical mask is enough. Only if you are a healthcare worker and you have been involved in an aerosol generating procedure on a COVID-19 confirmed case. And what would be those procedures? A cardiopulmonary resuscitation, intubation, bronchoscopy, non-invasive ventilation. So if you have been involved in these kind of things, only then do you need an N95 mask. And wearing gloves and a face shield are good ideas to prevent infection and self-inoculation. And as of now, I think we don't have a vaccine, we don't have a treatment. So the best way to mitigate the harm caused by this particular virus is self-isolation and social distancing. Prevention is the only thing we have for us, for ourselves today. So please take your lockdowns very seriously. Please stop going around unnecessarily. I know we can only advise that to others. Being healthcare workers, we have to be there. And one word for people who live with HIV and are immunocompromised, they are people who are at a high risk of infection and high risk of getting critical illness. So it is best if all people with HIV are asked to self-isolate themselves. So with these few words and summary about the talk, before I open the house, I would request Dr. Christine from CDC to please give her expert comments. Dr. Christine, please.
Hi, thank you, Dr. Vandana. Can you guys hear me okay? Yeah.
Dr. Christine, unmute.
Oh, you cannot hear me. Hold on 1 second. Hi, can you hear me? Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear.
Okay. All right. Sorry, I had you on a speakerphone. Thank you. I think Dr. Banandada, Dr. Rakesh Thuri, sorry, I'm pronouncing your name wrong. That was an outstanding session. I think that you really were able to hone in on the most important points, especially around infection control and the use of PPE, because this is such a big issue everywhere in the rest of the world, where we're seeing escalation of cases of COVID-19, where there are shortages of PPE because there's hoarding and incorrect use. So thank you for that. I would like to just add a few other things. I echo what you said about people living with HIV being especially vulnerable and needing to self-isolate and be extra careful. I would also say that is the same and especially true for people with TB. So in studies where they've looked at mortality rates among people with influenza, so not COVID-19, because we haven't had a COVID-19 sort of epidemic, this is the first one, but in other times where they've had the 1918 pandemic and other seasonal influenza, the mortality rate among TB patients was greater than those that did not have TB. And this was also true for HIV in South Africa. So I would say that piece. And the other piece is for all of you at the ART clinics, triage is really important. So I don't think that people will be coming to the clinics for routine care, but I don't know how that is working, but the triaging and the a rapid sort of separation and evaluation of people that have symptoms that could be COVID-19 are really important. And I think a lot of you know that Cepheid, who makes CBNet, has just gotten emergency use approval for a rapid test for COVID, for the coronavirus, right? Two, and where the results would be available in 45 minutes. What we don't know, which is amazing, right? And we have gene experts or CBNAT, so that is great. We don't know how long that will take, but I know that that's being expedited. So we could foresee in the future that we could set something up very nicely, right? At your centers and your facilities where there is triaging, people that have symptoms that could be COVID-19 get rapidly triaged and get specimens and get them tested, and 45 minutes later, you have a test result, and then there's the decision to, right, follow, isolate at home, have them come back and retest if needed, et cetera. But in terms of looking down the road for the future, I think this is a huge game changer and definitely gives me a little bit of a reassurance. I'll say that. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot, Dr. Christine, for joining us and giving your expert comments. Can I please now open the session to the House? Any questions, please? Even today, we don't have any questions? No questions today? I thought today's session, everybody would be asking questions. So is there a question from NTI Bangalore? Oh, Dr. I see that NTI Bangalore has also joined in. Would you like to give a comment, sir?
Ma'am, there is a question from Dr. C.K. Mate. Mm-hmm. Will vaccinated people on influenza vaccine, quadrivalent flu vaccine, have any protection against COVID-19?
So there's a question from Dr. C.K. Mate that people who have been vaccinated against influenza, that is the quadrivalent flu vaccine, would they have any protection against COVID-19? So I would pass the question on to Dr. Saini. Dr. Mate.
Hello, Dr. Mate, actually it's a totally a different virus. That is basically an influenza virus. That vaccine, flu quadri, is an influenza virus vaccine, and it is a different coronavirus. So that will not be effective in this. At present, there is no vaccine for coronavirus.
So influenzas are orthomyxoviridis, and COVID-19 and the SARS-CoV-2 is a coronaviridae. So it's a two different families total. Any more questions? NTI Bangalore, would you like to make a comment? Yeah, question please. Yeah. I think, yes sir, please go ahead. Yes sir.
I'm Dr. Venkatesh Rao from NART NRI Medical College. Thank you, madam. Good afternoon. And till now, we are having so many around 1 lakh and around cases to more than 2 lakhs. Any HIV patients already attacked by this coronavirus till now, we are having any evidences?
Sir, when very rightly asked question, sir, even I actually meant looking into the literature, if anybody with HIV has acquired COVID-19, so that we could see what was the course in that particular case. But yeah, I could not really find any evidence. I would just ask Dr. Christine. Dr. Christine, do you know of any HIV positive who got COVID-19?
I do not know of anybody with HIV that's gotten COVID-19. I can actually check and get an update from over the weekend, but I didn't hear any from my team.
So yeah. Thank you so much. So let's wait for an update from Dr. Christine. I was actually interested in two reasons. One was the course, and second, I wanted to know whether that patient was taking ritonavir, lopinavir, and was it somehow protected or whatever you could say. So this was actually my curiosity, and I went looking for cases, but I really couldn't find any in literature which could say that an HIV person got lopinavir.
Right.
Yes, sir.
One more question, madam.
Yes, sir.
Is it really useful with chloroquine, how it is useful? Preventing the corona multiplication in the cellular.
I will pass.
How it will be act as?
As as per latest available information, there is only in vitro activity has been found that to some extent this hydrochloroquine or hydroxychloroquine can inhibit the virus. But at present, though, no human study is available. So yeah, it can be used as off-label use. There is no recommendation at present by WHO.
Right. They're trying to start clinical trials, but there's nothing yet.
Because it is easily available and cheaper everywhere.
There is one other question from Raghavan Pathasathi, that what is the window period for retesting initial negative patient?
So Dr. Pathasathi wants to know, suppose there is a patient who has symptoms of COVID and also there's a travel history or a history of contact. Now he is a COVID suspect. You test him, he is negative, but you feel that he should be retested. So after
how many days
should he be retested, do you think?
And the patient is still asymptomatic?
He has symptoms. If he is symptomatic, we understand that if there is a patient who's asymptomatic, a contact who's asymptomatic, he need not be tested. Or if there's a strong travel history, I think one test would be enough, or would we have to test again?
At present, there is no literature available on the window period of this. But I have to check, because with the literature I have gone during this period, I have not seen anything here. What is the window period?
So
still not.
Yeah, I can weigh in a little bit here. I think what's been done is there has been repeat testing. I can't tell you about the frequency. I think it's probably done differently everywhere. Usually they think by 14 days that's the window period. If they were going to be positive, they would be. But that we also aren't so sure that that's the definitive window period either. So, you know, this is that kind of situation where case studies are very helpful. Every single case study that is published gives us new information.
Hello.
Hello, yes. Yes, please.
Upasna.
Good morning,
I just wanted, the viewers to also have your comments on the chances of reinfection for individuals who have otherwise taken care of their infection. They say 80% get free of the with mild symptoms only. So what is the chance that an individual once contracted will get reinfected?
Okay, so Dr. Saini, you have some knowledge on that?
No. So only few case reports have been reported, but still in the published literature, there is no data on this, how many patients are who are once declared as cured of COVID-19 and then again reinfected. At present, no published literature, but individual reports are there that some patients are getting reinfection.
So as far as I think anecdotal case reports are there, there have been two cases who have tested positive again after initial clearance of the virus. And I would request Dr. Christine if she has further information on this.
I do not have further information on this. And I think this is also very interesting. I think the data out of China will be very important for that too, to see. So whether there's kind of recrudescence and people getting reinfected again. But it's hard because there's always been a relative shortage of tests, right? Of testing everywhere, like I would say globally. So difficult to figure that out.
Okay, one other issue, Christine, now that you are online, you see, there are certain issues in policy which are a bit confusing. Some institutions are either closing down their OPDs or reducing their OPD time frame. Now, are we really missing out on the opportunity to catch patients in this manner? Because any individual who is having these symptoms may not really know what to do until and unless, I mean, you see, the OPD shifts to the emergency. Then emergency will be full of your OPD patients. It's a bit confusing. Could you throw light on this?
I will try, Dr. Serene. I will try. So, I think that in a perfect world, we would be doing this differently. I think in a perfect world, when we first had cases or contacts, exposed contacts coming from a single source, you would be testing them frequently, isolating, et cetera. I actually think that India did that very well with Kerala. And I think that's why the cases stayed very low for a long time. They were able to do that. But I think that what happened afterwards was that real life came in, and it wasn't from a single source. There was a lot of spread, because what happened was there were a lot of, you know, the lockdown in China happened probably about a month after there were cases, or maybe even more than a month, and there had been a lot of migration out already. Some percentage of them probably were infected and had COVID-19. So there's transmission going on that was untracked. And in that way, I think that what's happened all around the world is that there's probably transmission that isn't being tracked, but also along with that, there's a shortage of testing kits. And I think that's the issue. The issue is that, you know, there's an exponential curve of the epidemic, where in the beginning it's sort of, you know, if you have a doubling time, it's 1 to 2, 2 to 4, that's not that bad. But once you get to 320 to 640 to 12, right, 80, then you're seeing what we see everywhere, where over the weekend we doubled our cases. You know, the U.S. really doubled their cases.
No, but sorry for interrupting here.
No, it's okay.
But you see, the thing is that if we shut down our health facilities, mm-hmm. then how do we get an assessment of the cases? I mean, it's like closing your eyes and saying, okay, I have no case. Why? Because I have no health facility. Patient doesn't know what to do, where to go, and either they have self-cure or they die. I mean, it will be like that. Because if we shut down health facilities, whether that is the right approach, I am not very clear. So globally, is there any experience with this? That, okay, you shut down the OPDs, you shut down the facilities, and say, I have no case.
So I was going to loop back around to that, but thank you. So the current strategies that you see right now have to do with the fact that there are limited supplies of certain things. There's limited supplies of testing kits. There's limited supplies of PPE for the healthcare workers. And there's a very unknown denominator out there. The countries that have done very well, so you could say Singapore and South Korea, they've done extensive testing. There are other models out there that have decreased the exposure risk for healthcare workers. Like in South Korea, they have drive-by testing. So people drive in their cars, roll down the windows, you do the swabs, take all the information, and then go. They're doing that now in Seattle as well. And so I think it's just to reduce the risk for the healthcare facility and to prioritize the use of the healthcare facility for the more serious cases, for the people that need to be hospitalized. They have underlying medical conditions. They need to be observed more carefully. And then those that are going to be critically ill. So I don't think I have a clear answer for you, Dr. Serene. I think what I can just do is shine a little bit of light on why the strategies have been the way that they are right now. And I think it has to do with, basically, the American saying is, the horse is already out of the barn. So you're trying to chase it, you know? And so this is strategy because of that. I think that if there were enough tests and rapid tests, it would probably be done a different way, in the way that contact tracing for TB can be done, where you have every case, you actually test all of their contacts and you find them, right? We don't have a bunch of information. We don't know the window period. We don't know how long, you know, we should be testing them for.
And so in short, in short, if I understand this, that because of our inability to meet this challenge the right way, we are closing shop and saying that, nothing much can be done, and we'll focus only on those who get critical.
I would agree with that. I mean, I think that every country is doing it differently, and I mean, I don't have that much. I have the same insight into the current strategies that you have, but I think it's the limitation in it's the limitation in resources that's dictating how they're doing it right now. What they don't want is people to be coming in and spreading it to other people that don't have it.
No, but there are no other people because the OPD is shut. So it's not that, especially when larger institutions shut down OPDs, there is no one coming there.
But so that's why they shut it down, yeah?
So there are no people to infect and there are no people who will infect. It is something like this. Anyway, so I think I have got your point. Thank you so much for... because I was wondering, maybe CDC is having some strategy in this direction. Apparently, it is failure of the health services which is forcing them to shut shop rather than anything else.
It is attempts to reduce damage control. I would say that.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Dr. Upasna, are you there? Can you speak now?
No, you are. Yeah, I can hear you, Ajit. Can you hear me?
Yeah, sure.
So thank you. Thank you very much for this very, very informative session. And I really thank our senior colleagues for joining in. And we thank you for your questions. And now I would request Ajit
to
do the poll.
First poll I already submitted.
Yeah. So I think with that, we would sign off. And if there are any more questions, we would be happy to take them from by email and be back to you on email. And with this, we will session. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So there is an electric fluctuation in the Delhi hub. So the people are not able to talk to you. So thanks for all participation. Kindly submit your post poll. So then there is one more feedback poll is there. Then we can say bye and thanks all, even from the ECO team, Gaurav and his friend, and Dr. Vandana and Dr. from NITRD, the specialist also. So we will see you in the next section. It will be announced by email. By the time, all stay safe and follow the government regulations for the infection control, and the other things will be supplied, means distributed by the government departments, health departments. Thank you very much.